Je serai là à 2 heures, gardez-moi une place.
Apporte de l'argent si tu perdais.
Je ne perds jamais. Jamais vraiment.
The Samourai is a French existential noir movie directed by Pierre Melville, starring Alain Delon. No, the other one.
Upon its original release, this movie was known as Godson in the USA, as El Silencio de un Hombre, Silence of a Man in Spain, which is interestingly enough a reference to the first feature movie Melville ever made, La Silence de la Mer, Silence of the Sea. It's also known as Franco Stello the Angel Face in Italy.
His name is not even Frank in the movies, it's Jeff. The roots of the Franco Stello name change I can kinda trace. I think it's a reference to Franco Stello, famous American-Italian crime boss. But the angel face part is just...
The Samurai is a very well-regarded movie by audiences and critics alike, spawning remakes as well as inspiring movies and characters, and landing on high spots and multiple top lists.
It influenced so much stuff, and for me most notably and importantly The Taxi Driver, so much of other movies indirectly that even Jim Jarmusch's Ghost Dog, which is tonally and thematically and character-wise and world-wise and everything-wise is a completely different movie, and Jarmusch himself never admitted to have any connection to Los Samurai or Melville, it still shares a bunch of similarities, although more cosmetic rather than thematic. Both characters are kinda samurai. Both live in a crummy apartment.
The RZA.
They both have a keylog that opens a specific car model. Birds.
The ghost dog seemed to be somebody that was in the shadows. I mean, somebody in your hood that's there, that you know him for years, you know, OG, nobody don't mess with him.
Movie shows us a few days of life of a killer for hire, Jeff Costello, played by Alain Delon. His everyday life surroundings, people he interacts with, his secluded and professional modus operandi, the ways he deals with living a witness during an assassination he conducts, and consequent problems with police and his employers, all of that, with our character generally maintaining a high level of emotionless, with an added hint of accepted absurdity of surrounding reality. The movie was directed and co-written by Pierre Melville, who, amongst other things, was a Jew under Nazi occupation, French resistance fighter, Americanophile who wore Stetson hat and giant shades, studio independent filmmaker, and a person that was very keen on making shit up. There is a quote that appears in the beginning of Los Samurai which reads, "There is no greater solitude than that of a samurai, unless it is that of a tiger in a jungle." Perhaps. Movie attributes this quote to the Book of Bushido, but it so happens that this quote was completely made up by Melville. It's interesting that tradition of quoting non-existent Eastern philosophy quotes was continued by director in his later movie Le Cercle Rouge.
So what you gonna do? Gotta Google that stuff. Sorry to break it out for you, because 1967, you don't have internet on your phone. Your phone is like disk to input the numbers. So like, if you want to check whether or not the quotes are true, you need to go to the library and read every single thing about the matter. Or like, maybe, I don't know, found like a professor and take like a 5-year course in Asian studies.
Although Melville might have added some bullshit into certain elements of the movie, unquestionably, he actually took very good care of most of the other elements. He have put tremendous effort, among other things, into sets, which, interestingly enough, he did twice because his first set just went ablaze in a studio fire. In the Jeff's apartment, for example, he went as far as to remove all color labels from bottles and cigarettes, replacing them with black and white copies, and even paper money in certain things are exchanged with black and white analogs. With additional desaturated look and generally minimalistic surroundings lacking bright colors and bright objects, this movie is as close to being black and white as possible while still being in color. Movie looks incredible, and honestly I don't know if Melville could have pulled this thing without him. It's interesting also that Decaillé had previous experiences with black and white French neo-noir movies in the 50s with Elevator to the Gallows, which in itself is a topic for another video. Soundtrack for the movie was created by Rubeau, who is maybe not my most favorite movie composer from the 70s. But still, this movie is a clear case of a piece in which music actually tremendously helps not only with the tone of particular scenes, but also augments the movie as a whole, its themes and motives. The movie is constantly trying to show us that Jeff is not some sort of a metaphor, that Jeff is in fact a real human, a cadaver. He gets shot. It hurts like ass. You need to take care of it. He needs to sleep after his sleepless nights. He drinks water and smokes cigarettes. He has his own kitchen and even a little bird friend. His humanity is essential to the perception and experiences that led him to be in the place in which he currently is. A loner who lives in a crummy apartment, who is not talkative, who has attention of attractive woman, who is very prominent in some skill, and who dies in the end, doing what he is good at. It's easy to relate to the character that doesn't say much because he can put absolutely any thought in his head. It's cool that character having certain power and control over certain elements is not a complete dickwad and actually is a good human being at some point of his existence. Dedication to the field usually creates high-level professional with highly developed skills and suggests high level of industriousness, which makes them desirable mates for females and desirable partners to males. For a failed man, it's easy to associate oneself with a character similar to those. There is an AMV on YouTube. MV, V, CMV, whatever. There is a montage of scenes from Lost Samurai with Kaminsky's Nightcrawl. I noticed an interesting thing with this movie. The word existentialism is used a lot in reviews and comments and even like in academic literature on the topic. It was very interesting to me that even before I started watching this movie, the word existential kind of was in my head. It was long before reading all the comments and all the reviews and all that other stuff. When I asked myself, but why? I couldn't answer for a while, and actually needed to do some research and kind of think about it. Concepts and ideas of existentiality and existential are implanted in our modern culture and strongly connected with certain behaviors and even looks and environments. This connection is so strong, in fact, that I feel that ideas causing certain behaviors in a common mind become behaviors themselves and cumulatively characters and environments. And I think this is exactly what happened to me. Or, you know, I might just be a hack fraud. Why Jeff Costello is existential? He doesn't go around listening to swans and reading Camus, and he's not 17, so why? Simplifying what existential is, we can say that Jeff is existential because his life at some point, for whatever reason, became or just was meaningless. And choosing to find meaning, he found one in serving a skill at the best achievable level. If everything is absurd, the meaning you find for yourself might be absolutely anything. Religion, gardening, making YouTube videos nobody watches, or killing people. There are a lot of little things that can be seen as implicit nods and winks to absurdism and existential uncertainness in the Jeff's character and in the movie itself. Perhaps, in the end of the fake opening quote, Jeff's dialogue with the bar owner.
Qui êtes-vous? Aucune importance.
And with the assassin.
Je ne parle jamais à un homme qui tient une arme dans la main.
C'est une règle.
Une habitude.
Small bird that doesn't seem to have much meaning in a character's life until it actually plays a crucial role in helping character avoid the danger. But the director of the movie was wearing Stetson hat, and therefore it is too much of a bold assumption to suppose that Melville have embedded so much deep meanings in a small object and nods in his neo-noir eye candy criminal drama. Author existed in a certain environment which I assume was oversaturated with existential types of thought. The same year as the movie came out, The Man Asleep was published. The Man Asleep is so fucking existential. And honestly speaking, I thought that Melville was actually inspired by the book. This movie feels honest and has profound effect on audiences. And as any movie, it can be analyzed as Lynch Kubrick movie, but the question is, should it be analyzed as one? Searching for little nooks and crannies of meaning? I mean, it's fun for once, but should we? Given who the creator was?
Comment trouvez-vous vos films?
Ah, je ne les trouve pas.
Different cultures and postulations of said cultures are a lot of times very different, that's why we divide them into different cultures. But there are certain elements that, on the most basic level, relate to the same states emotionally and from the standpoint of narration to the same or similar characters. And I'm not talking about Jungian archetypes, I'm talking about communality of experiences that might be very specific and induced by different conditions in different cultures. Let's say a samurai which master have died in Edo, Japan, and a young male who lost a desire for doing what he was doing in Paris, France in 1960s. Those situations are not the same, but experiences of characters, although not identical, share a lot of similarities. The things that sometimes seem non-compatible at the basic level actually produce a compelling mix, because in the end they are about the same thing more or less. The noir setting, Japanese culture allusions, fedoras and trench coats, a silent loner protagonist, possesses somewhat pejorative meaning in our everyday culture, but as anything, their meaning can be multiplied, and are in fact multiplied. If you remove the veil of quote-unquote cringe, those things just click together very well and create a very enjoyable, if not even relatable, experience. Somehow, pretentious Americanophilic director, babyface star, existential themes mixed with noir world and characters, references to Japanese culture just work together. Or maybe cinematography just glues this thing together. In the original ending, Landelon's character was supposed to smile while being shot by a policeman in the last scene. In the final cut, he didn't.